Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Good day to you, my friend, and welcome to the broadcast, the Monday edition here at Bible Tract Echoes. Thank you for making us a part of your day. Right now, my Bible is open in front of me. It's open to 2 Peter in the very last two verses of that book. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 17 and 18 will be our focus for much of this week. So if you can, get out your own copy of the Word of God and join me there and get something on which you can jot some notes. I really try almost every single day to give a very clear outline of the passage before us. We have a number of things I would like for you to jot down. I think if you jot them down, you can review them later on and get even more out of the passage as you let the Spirit of God be your real teacher. But also with that pen and paper handy, you can jot down our contact information so that you can receive a free gift from us, a free sample pack out of our gospel tracts. I'm going to say more about that here in just a moment. To help us lead into the Bible study time, let me begin this way. There's an old proverb that's credited to Benjamin Franklin, and it goes like this. For want of a nail, the shoe was lost. For want of a shoe, the horse was lost. For want of a horse, the rider was lost. For want of a rider, the battle was lost. For want of a battle, the kingdom was lost. And all for want of a horseshoe nail. Now, that's the proverb. It's found in Poor Richard's Almanac. And the point of this saying is pretty simple and obvious. There have been many unforeseen major consequences that resulted from small things. Small things that either were done or were failed to get done. Well, I'm saying this because as we come to the end of 2 Peter, we come to the final two verses. These two verses are Peter's final challenge to believers, and his challenge involves a couple of small things. But these small things are going to determine major spiritual consequences, either for good or bad, in the next years of our walk with Christ until he comes. Get your Bible, the end of 2 Peter. Please join me there, if at all possible. I mentioned my wanting to give you a free gift of a sample packet of our gospel tracts. Bible Tract Echoes is the radio arm of the larger ministry called Bible Tracts Incorporated, and that word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. We're referring to an evangelism tool. It's a short written presentation of God's plan of salvation. We have a sample packet containing over 40 different gospel tracts, each one very clearly laying out God's plan of salvation, but each one comes at that message from a different vantage point. I have one in my hand right now entitled, Where Are the Dead? Where are the dead? Beloved friend, so many people are thinking and mulling over this kind of a question. What happens to people when they die? Where are the dead? Let me read you part of this tract. This part is directed to those who have never received Jesus as their Savior. He says this, and I'm quoting now, God sees you in your sin, unfit for heaven. And there shall in no wise enter into it anything that defileth. To die in your sins means you die without forgiveness, without cleansing, without hope. You die under the judgment and penalty of death. Ye shall die in your sins, said the Lord, and where I go, ye cannot come. This tract is very, very clear that without Jesus Christ as Savior, you will die in your sins and not go to heaven. But Christ did die on the cross for your sins, and if you receive him, you can go to heaven, and rather than dying in your sins, you die in Christ. That's a great, great gospel tract here. Please, I want to give it to you. Would you let me send you that free gift? If you'll take down our contact information that'll be given at the end of the broadcast, give us your name and mailing address, we'll send you that sample packet absolutely free of charge. If you can't wait to the very end of the broadcast, just go to our website, which is BibleTractsInc.org. We told you how to spell Tracts, BibleTractsInc.org. If your Bible's open here, look at the last two verses of 2 Peter, verses 17 and 18 say this, "Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness, but grow in grace and in knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen." For the fourth time here in this third chapter, Peter refers to his readers as beloved ones. Now, with each of those uses of that title, beloved, Peter gave a challenge. And frankly, one way in which many pastors have outlined chapter 3 is by using those four beloved statements. It's a pretty good outline. Let me show them to you here. The first one is in verses 1 and 2. There it says, beloved, and here's the challenge, be mindful, and there be mindful of Scripture and its value in living your life while there's so many false teachers around. Each one of these warnings will be begin with a B word. So number one, be mindful. The second, beloved, is found in verse 8, and there we're told to be informed. We are to be informed of how God used time. The third one is in verse 14. There we're told to be diligent, to be diligent to live a holy life during these days when so many false teachers are saying so many ugly things. But now we come here to verses 17 and 18. He calls them beloved for the fourth time, but now the warning is this, beware, beware. Believers are warned and they're told to take care lest they too become unstable in God's truth and drift away from godly living. Now, frankly, as I said a moment ago, that's not a bad outline for this third chapter. That's not the outline I've been using. For my part, verses 17 and 18 are segment number 6 in my outline for chapter 3, and I've been using a series of words all beginning with the letter F, like in the word flower, to be my titles for each of the 6 sections. Section 1 was verses 1 and 2, and my word was focus. Section 2 was verses 3 through 7, and my word there was first. It's actually found in there in verse 3. The section number 3 is verses 8 and 9. My word for that is faithfulness. Section number 4 is just verse 10, and there it's the word fire. And then verses 11 to 16, I use the word follow. How do we follow God while in the midst of this crooked and perverse day? And now the last two verses are segment number 6, and the word there is footing. Footing. I'm using the word footing to refer to the idea that Peter warns believers to keep their footing, to keep their spiritual steadfastness. Now, don't allow yourself, he says, to drift away from the truth that you already know. If you're one that takes notes and jots down some notes under these various segments, first of all, jot down this word, before, or before truth. After calling his readers beloved ones, that's a very tender term, Peter is now going on to warn them, and he begins, though, by reminding them of before truth. Verse 17 starts this way, "Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before." In my very first job in ministry, after I graduated from Bible college, I got roundly chewed out by the pastor that I was serving. I had failed to do something. But then the pastor came to realize that he had never told me that I was responsible to accomplish that task. So he quickly came and he openly apologized. Friend, I've never forgotten that leadership lesson. I have great respect for that pastor, even in his old age to this day. Well, I say that because here, Peter is going to expect the believers to not lose their footing on truth. And his challenge is based upon the fact that they've been told some stuff. They've been told truth. They are being warned now about false teachers all through the last two chapters, chapter 2 and 3. Now, because of what they have been knowing before, it is right, it is proper to expect the saints to live up to the challenge. Oh, friend, tell me, just how much Bible truth have you been taught over the years? For me, I've been taught God's Word virtually all my life. I had godly parents. I attended a Bible preaching Sunday school and church. I went to a Bible college. And honestly, I have been taught a ton of truth. Maybe, though, you're something like me, that there are times that I fail to use what I've been taught. My problem, you see, is not the lack of before truth. My problem is the lack of beware truth. If you're taking notes, after the idea of before truth, jot down the words beware truth. Again, he called them to beware based upon the truth. When Mark Smith stumbles and loses his footing in his walk with Christ, it's not due to my lack of knowledge. It's due to my lack of being aware of what's going on and what's happening. Verse 17 goes on to say this, "Beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness." Now that word steadfastness has already been used here in 2 Peter. Back in chapter 1, verse 12, Peter wrote this, "Wherefore I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though you know them, and be established," there's the word, "established in the present truth." The word established in 1:12 and the word steadfastness here in 3:17 translate the same Greek word. It's a word of maturity in spiritual things. That's a word describing believers who have learned the balance of living the Christian life. The balance involves two things. Number one, knowing God's grace and power. And number two, knowing my personal need to be working and putting effort into my life. Sinners, yes, sinners get into the family of God totally by grace without any work on their part. But once you become a child of God, we use God's power to practice, and we deliberately cooperate with God in the growing stronger in Christ. Here's the takeaway for us today. Peter is warning mature believers to beware lest they go from steadfast saints to stumbling saints. And if he writes to those mature believers then, and it's possible for them to lose and fall and drift from steadfastness, then it's possible for you and I to do the same thing. So let's be warned. We have before truth, but now let's heed the beware truth. And so be alert to what's going on and not drift away from the truth on doctrine and holy living. Amen? Amen.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888, and our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve Him.